Hello everyone, my name is ERKHAN and I'm the creative director of HeroCraft. And we are both game developer and publisher, and I hope you know some of our games. So our portfolio includes games of different genres, and since the time of Java games and the very first mobile devices, we have been focused on strategy games, and that's why we have some practical experience in production of such games, and I want to share it with you. During this session, I will speak about different game design tasks, and it means that it's for game designers and project managers primarily, not for producers or business people. I will speak mostly about games, not about money. And during this session, I will raise different game design issues, and I also will speak about some problems which we were faced with trying to accomplish them in HeroCraft, and I also will speak about some possible solutions. First of all, let's define what mobile mid-core strategy is nowadays. And if we examine top charts of this genre, we will see that they are variety of game mechanics, from city builders and tower defense to classical PC style strategies. And that's why I tend to think that this genre nowadays is not a set of game mechanics, but a mindset, some way of thinking which is demanded from players. Players should determine the chain or the order of task, and they also should manage resources which they have for the successful completing of this task. Some kind of decision make games. And I will use this term just within this definition in my session. So let's start with the first and maybe the most important game design task, the first production challenge, introducing your game to players. And as you understand, the more complicated your game is, the more difficult this task is. And it looks like the teaching problem for mid-core games is tougher comparing casual games. But on the other hand, our audience is better prepared, so we don't have to explain some basic rules. So what are the traps which are waiting on the way of introducing users to our exciting gameplay? I want to speak about three of them, and they can appear separately, of course, but I want to examine them as a complex problem. So here they are. Tutorial doesn't fulfill its purposes, main mechanic isn't obvious, and some features stay hidden to players. So, the saddest thing is that it's almost impossible to avoid the first trap. Even if you make an interactive, unskippable tutorial, it's not guaranteed that users will be able to grasp info or use this info. And besides that, it's always worth remembering that a detailed, officious tutorial is the best way to lose players. They just can drop and never seen the core gameplay. So. You know that it's great to integrate tutorial into gameplay directly, but it's also the guarantee of nothing. And of course, tutorial which doesn't fulfill its purposes as a solo problem isn't very dangerous. Of course, if users stay in game and they understand what they should do and what's important how to do, but even these players who think that they understand game mechanic might miss some important features which consumed a lot of your resources in time, and they just will never open their pretty faces to users. So I fell into all these traps badly in Medieval Wars. And it's our turn-based strategy and classical war game style with a simplistic battle system. But this simple battle system has one key element, the importance of the encirclement of enemy forces. Trying to make an accurate historical games, we have balanced this game such a way that troops never fight till the last man standing. They always try to retreat in free spaces. And if you want to destroy enemy troops with guarantee, you should to cut all the routes to escape. So, sounds easy, but it isn't. And in medieval wars, we face a situation which are called the Viking's Curses. So, it was the very first campaign of the game. It was about British Isles. We see the dawn of the English history, the year of 1013, when the united forces of Vikings intruded England. So, players had the army of Englishmen, and they have double advantage in strength, and it was very easy first level. And of course, we taught how encircle enemies in tutorial, but we see the first red flag during our internal testing. People just didn't understand that they have to encircle enemies, and they just made frontal attacks. And heavy armored Vikings retreated, but survived, and they wandered such a way across England, killing step by step poorly armed Englishmen. So, of course, we explained to other colleagues how to play in the right way, and we also fixed the balance. But anyway, the problem was harder because strength advantage just didn't work if players didn't encircle enemies. So, just before the release, we made Vikings forces weaker once more, so the map could be completed just in one single turn. And what did we see after the release? 60% drop. 60% of users were unable to finish this map. They didn't get the main mechanic, and they failed to win the level, which could be passed in one turn. And players even start to blame us, saying that we made a paywall fail. As a result, we made even an easier version of this level, and we made a video walkthrough where it was shown how to pass this level in one turn. But anyway, these actions helped reduce the drops, but we fell into the traps. And how was it possible to avoid them? Playtests. I don't know how they organize in your companies, and it's great if they are part of production. And I guess you know how important they are. And if you don't have such tests, I just can't say that you should make them anyway. Give your games to everybody, to every person you can get, force your friends, relatives, and colleagues to play. But the more important thing, you should listen to your playtesters. So don't think that you are a mature game designer who actually knows what people actually want, and don't think that your playtester does a piece of dumb ass who are too lazy to understand the rules of your genius game. Be sure that your future players won't puzzle out your product too, but you won't be near to say them how wrong they are. So make playtests and listen to your playtesters. Take into consideration what they are saying about. The second solution, reduce the price of mistakes. In medieval wars, I failed. The price of mistakes was too high. It was critical. People just weren't able to go further, and in case of medieval wars, I just needed to change heavy infantry to usual spearmen, or just change wind condition on something that didn't demand destroying Viking troops. And the third, Analyze your data. So I hope you collected by Flurry, Google Analytics, or your own services. And I'm speaking about game events exactly, not about monetization metrics, but about users' behavior in your game. And statistic isn't for producers and business analytics only. If you speak about the game events, not about usual drops, but about something that concerns mechanic, I'm sure that only game designer can understand if everything goes right. And I'll repeat once more, the statistic is not only an instrument for improvement of your balance or monetization. It's a story. It's a story in numbers about your game, about content, user interface, controls, it's story for you. And turn this process of analyzing into the endless continuous circle. Collect the data, analyze, react, and then examine how data reacts in return. And stop this circle only when you are satisfied with the results, when you see that your actions has led to the victory and success. I wouldn't deny the importance of the monetization, virality, retention, and other vice words. But anyway, the main element of any game, the essence, is fun. And when you have fun in your game, you have an opportunity to make your game famous and successful. And if you don't have, it's much harder. So, our goals as game designers is to make our games pure, unstoppable fun. But unfortunately, different boring things are always on the way. All these budgets, milestones, deadlines, resources, and so on. And that's why in production, it's a common thing when outstanding, innovative ideas sparkling with fun turns into another gloom, buggy cripple. And it's good when this cripple is released finally, because a great number of projects are closed very often in every big companies, shooting the dead horses. You know, we make this at HeroCraft every few months. And very often projects are closed, especially because of the fun, which wasn't designed, but just have vanished, totally gone in production. So where does it usually go? First of all, let's talk about our best friend and who might turn into the worst enemy, about feature card. Everyone who has the experience how to lead a game from the beginning to the release knows how it's necessary to use this instrument. And there's no big sense repeating once more that we game designers should make the whole design of the project in such a way that deleting of one element or one feature doesn't spoil the whole gameplay. But the force of circumstances, sometimes we have to sacrifice a lot. And having risk to lose something special, something fun-reducing, or even fun-killing, and sometimes we face very tough choices. And so be careful with such powerful weapon as feature card, which can revive your project or able to bury it easily. And it's also dangerous when we focus only on some functional things or even content, trying to implement more and more features and forget about gameplay itself. So just hope that cool mechanic will provide that mysterious fun. And we have faced both of the threats in production of lots of Discord. It's a mobile strategy, of course, and inspired by well-known disciples. And originally, it had almost the same features as its PC predecessor, but unfortunately, we failed to implement all of the features which were planned. because the budget and deadlines, and we were forced to delete the main game mode campaign, some level features like terramorphing, some playable races, and other features. We weren't very important separately, but altogether they make that cool gameplay of Disciples. And during production, we have tested gameplay itself close to none. Of course, we had a vision, or we played original Disciples, and we fought against different functional problems, trying to implement a lot and created units and in heroes, but for example, we didn't work on battle system. As a result, this autumn, we had a project with a great variety of different features, but it's not quite enough to call Lot of Discord a game, and we need another few months of production. And I want you to pay attention to at this point, and I want to split up these two terms, gameplay and game mechanics. As a publisher, we at HeroCraft very often find ourselves in situation when some indie teams bring their games to us, and they think that the game is almost done. It's only needed to fix monetization, make promo materials, and that's all. Just download it into the store, push the button to release, and gain money. Unfortunately, it's just exactly the same trap which I'm speaking about. A lot of developers mix the ideas of gameplay and mechanics, and they bring to us a game with a fully working functional, no question, but there is no gameplay in these builds, and that means there's no fun. So what is gameplay exactly, and why we can say that it's equal to the fun? Oops. Gameplay is a mechanic plus goals, persistence, challenge, and metagaming. And yep, you're right, there are some games, sandboxes, mainly in where original gameplay doesn't have all of these elements, but these elements are added to the games by players themselves via add-ons, modes, or even mental stories. But are you sure that players will add them to your game? So our goal as game developers is to give all these elements to players. But how? So I just repeat the truism, but make prototypes, really. Make them as early as possible, and I think you know that a lot of companies set prototypes as the base of their production system. Wooga, Supercell, Rovio, all of them work with prototypes where they test not only mechanic but gameplay and fun. And as for my own experience, I want to speak about the strategy and tactics series. Nowadays, it's spec of about a dozen of games, but all of them had one solo prototypes, which we received after 4 months of production. It was just only one map, one type of unit, no game progress or meta game or artificial intelligence. We just made a PvP mode, hot seat PvP mode, and there was fun core gameplay, and it never has been changed for the next 2 years of production. So it means we started from gameplay and use it at a static point, and then build a whole game strategies on it. So how did we build? Second point, have a clear vision of your game circle. How will your mechanics survive day from day? And I'm speaking not about retention, but about the persistence. What will motivate players to keep playing, keep going? And I suggest to make a brief version of game circle, mostly for yourself. It could be simple, just complete level, upgrade unit, and start another level, or more complicated. It depends on genres and mechanic. But you should see it mostly for yourself, because if you don't see it, you have a risk that players will not find it too, and you will have a risk to lose players regardless how great your mechanic is. So keep going. Spend as much time as possible to test your own gameplay. Play it again and again. I force my game designers to play every build that they have, because if there are any annoying element in the gameplay, so it will bother the game designer and he will fix it. Unfortunately, I know a lot of game designers who like play their games by play only in their minds. And when they make game design documents or general design and playing mental prototypes, as they say. So it's wrong practice, totally wrong. There is no excellent paper or mind design, and you just can't create gameplay from scratch just in your mind. Play and test your ideas, make doubt controls, make doubt game user interface balance, make doubt other thing, and your core gameplay must be perfect, absolutely perfectly polished, and all other elements could be fixed later. And finally, goals. I consider goals as a simple way to boost the persistence in your game. And you see, nowadays goals play the same role as levels in many genres. Platformers, racing, arcades, runners, a lot of free-to-play games in these genres don't have levels, but have a system of clear short-term goals. And it's not well-known system of achievements, but a new system of user progress in games. And it really works, and set goal to users, and they will always have something to do in your game. And in my last release game, Sandbox Set Engine Tactics, which is a sandbox game in a setting of World War II, we added a system of tasks for every playable country. We don't say just, hey dude, here's a war and 20 countries, just choose one of them and try conquer the whole world. It was great for the old PC times, it was great in the games of Hearts of Iron series, but I don't think that it really works nowadays on mobile. And instead of this, we just make a lot of goals for every country, and players shouldn't play for 2 weeks to conquer the Euro by their small country like Sweden. Instead of this, they just complete a task in a day in a 3 or 4 short sessions, and they complete short-term goals, and they enjoy their victories, and they unlock new task and have joy again. And I mean, goals motivate players to keep playing, and they also give rewards for their completing. And I think that this casual system really works in our mid-core world. And of course, goals drive monetization very well, but money is just another topic for another session. So finally, I just want to say thank you for your time, and wish you good games, more challenges, and no traps. Thank you.
Hi, everyone.
Hi.
Yeah. My question may appear very simple, but I'm sure maybe some other people also thinking it. Could you please define what is mid-core game according to you? Because as a game designer, I have discussed this subject a lot with different kind of developers, and every developer had different opinion on what mid-core actually is. So could you please give your version?
I think there is no right answer for this question. I consider mid-core players as a two groups of players. The first one is players who just make steps from the casual games to the new territory. They satisfied with the casual games and they try to find something new. And another group of players are the hardcore players who like hardcore games and who play a lot on consoles or PC. But nowadays they don't have enough time for the hardcore gaming, and that's why they are seeking for something that is have some hardcore elements and gameplay, but these games don't try to take hours for everyday playing. So
yeah, so basically not requiring investment from the player as much as hardcore titles.
Yep, you're right. Because hardcore gameplay with the short sessions, maybe something like that.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.